Technology impacts every aspect of our lives, but the people creating this technology aren't representative of its user population. These creators are disproportionately male. It wasn't always this way. When the field of computer science first began, it had a higher percentage of women than most other fields. So why were so many of the first programmers female? And what happened that made them all disappear?
I think it's so important to include women and other minorities in technical fields, because if we don't have them, it's like we're not catering to half our user population. Diverse teams just make stronger products, more diverse decisions, and there's more perspectives to consider, different angles. You know, everyone has a different story that they're living, and when they're put together on a project team, they're thinking from their perspective. And so when you have more people in the room that are different from each other, including women and minorities who are usually less included in these rooms, you're just going to get a better product out of it.
In 2002, I founded the Technology Goddesses nonprofit because in the first 25 years of working, there weren't a lot of women in my position. And so in 2002, I started studying, well, what are we doing? What can we do differently? What are the reasons that bright girls go into medicine or law? You know, what's keeping them away from computers and technology?
My name is Jenny Stanchak, and I am an entrepreneur and a CTO. So I work with my husband, Chris, and we have a company called LoveSeat.com. And we run online auctions, primarily for like vintage furniture and home decor. And so we have a website that has auctions in San Diego and Los Angeles every week. And all the bidding is conducted online through our own platform. And I have built 100% of it myself. Before this, I was the seventh employee at Venmo. That was my first software engineer type of job. And I was the first and only girl there for a very, very long time. I had come to software engineering kind of by a circuitous route. Took about 9 months off of like working a regular job and taught myself computer science. So I started by taking MIT classes online. And I guess it required some self-motivation because there was no actual teacher grading my work. But I was just really interested in learning a new field. And then after I finished that class, I kept teaching myself by kind of coming up with a project. I'd be like, well, I want to build a website that, you know, shows me a map where my friends are. So I'd come up with that idea and I'd be like, well, how do I do that? So I did a lot of Googling. Googling is awesome. It was like, how do you make a website? And so I started, following another tutorial online about how to make a website. And it was like, okay, well, how do I put a map on the website? So I started following a tutorial about how to put the map on the website. And with each kind of part of my project, my knowledge base grew. And then I was able to think of different, more challenging projects until I got to a point where I knew enough that I was able to be hired by somebody.
During World War II, men left to fight in the war, and women were encouraged to take on the wartime jobs that men had left behind. This opportunity greatly expanded the breadth of fields women were allowed into, although women continued to primarily work in low-status jobs. The feminization of ballistics computing was one example of women's jobs changing. Before World War II, ballistics computing, the calculation of the flight behavior and impact of bullets, bombs, and rockets, was considered primarily male work. When millions of men went off to fight, those remaining were given the upper-level jobs. Women were then brought in to fill the role of human computers who performed low-level computing. Ballistics computing was very difficult and required an advanced mathematical education. However, it became known as women's work, and it was regarded as work that was beneath the men who held the same degrees as women working these jobs. In 1946, John Malkley and J. Presper Eckert invented the Electronic Numerical Integrator and Computer, or ENIAC, which could solve complex mathematical equations much faster than the human computers. People were needed to run the new machines, so the human computers, now primarily women, were recruited. These pioneering women were the first regularly working programmers. Their job was to program complex mathematical equations for the ENIAC to solve. However, there was no manual for the process, so these women had to figure out how to program the ENIAC on their own. They were given the schematics for the machine, and from that, they collaborated to determine how to program the ENIAC. By learning how to operate the machine, these women came to know the ENIAC even better than its creators.
I think in terms of technology, you have to be constantly learning. It doesn't matter what you know today, because 3-6 months from now, it's all going to be different. So you have to be constantly learning. You have to be a self-starter. You have to be curious about things to survive in a technology job.
As I was preparing to get out of college, I got 2 job offers. One was to be a code breaker for the NSA, and one was to be a programmer. And I'd never actually touched a machine, so that seemed pretty interesting to me. So I taught myself Assembler and Fortran 4+. And once I started programming, it was like game over. This was what I was meant to do. I really, really loved coding, and I still do. So I was a successful programmer, but I wanted to learn more. So I started a doctorate in computer science at UCLA while I was also working full-time. I put that on pause to go back to the East Coast. So while I was in New Jersey, I started a master's in computer science. I also formally started studying for an electrical engineering doctorate.
Despite the ENIAC programmers' enormous contribution to the field of programming, they were not acknowledged. Their difficult and complicated work was denigrated as women's work. The popular notion was that the real genius lay in the invention of the machine, not its operation. Because their work was downplayed, the women were not featured in advertisements for the ENIAC. An edited photo used in Army ads showed a man working on the machine, although in the original image, many women can be seen working nearby. Because the ENIAC women were the first computer operators, they paved the way for the feminization of the field. Programming was seen as clerical work. Employers preferred to hire women as computer operators because they believed women were better suited for clerical work than men. A computer operator needed to be patient and detail-oriented, which were considered feminine skills. This belief caused computer operation to be regarded as a pink-collar job, which meant that it was considered women's work.
Some of the challenges I faced being a woman in computer science is being either the only or being one of the very few female developers on project team. This is everywhere in the industry, and it's kind of hard to combat, and there are many different reasons for it. But it does kind of weigh on you when you are thinking, did that previous interaction or did that action or did they say that because I'm a woman? You can't help thinking, is it because of gender or is it not? And so everything starts to feel like a gender issue, even if it's not, because you're the only woman in the room. You have this extra mental load that other team members are needing to think about. And because you're the only one on the team like that, you're the only one in that position. And so it becomes very isolating.
Of the many influential women in the history of computer science, 2 of the most notable are Ada Lovelace and Grace Hopper. Ada Lovelace is known as the first computer programmer. In 1843, she collaborated with Charles Babbage on the difference in analytical engines, considered to be the foundation for the modern computer. She formulated many basic principles for a general-purpose programmable computing machine. She established what operations the machine would need to conduct to solve mathematical problems, and long before the invention of electronic computers, she also developed the loop and subroutine concepts still used in modern-day programming. Grace Hopper is the other most prominent woman in computer science history. While working at the Eckert-Mauchly Computer Corporation, she supervised the department that developed the first compiler, which converted programmers' instructions into the more arcane machine codes, making programming much more intuitive. She later developed the Flowmatic programming language, the first English language data compiler. Hopper famously coined the term bug, an error in a computer program when she discovered a moth inside the Mark I computer that caused the computer to malfunction. By literally debugging the machine, Hopper fixed the problem. Another important woman, Edith Clark, paved the way for other women to break into new technological professions. At the beginning of her career, Clark managed an all-female team of human computers for AT&T. Later, she enrolled in a graduate program at MIT and became the first woman to earn a master's degree in electrical engineering. While studying at MIT, she invented the Clark calculator, which simplified a set of complex calculations, allowing them to be solved 10 times faster. A few years after graduating, she got a job as an electrical engineer at General Electric, becoming the first professional female electrical engineer. Evelyn Boyd Granville is another important woman in the history of computer science. She was the second African-American woman to receive a doctoral degree in mathematics. During her career, she wrote programs for the IBM 650 and IBM 704. While working at IBM's Vanguard Computing Center, she also wrote computer programs that tracked orbits for the unmanned Vanguard satellite and the manned Mercury spacecraft. Other key women in computer science include Sister Mary Kenneth Keller, who played a significant role in developing the basic computer language. This language allowed people who weren't mathematicians or scientists to write custom software. Rheta Perlman created the algorithm that underlies the internet. Gladys West laid the foundation for the calculations that led to the global positioning system. Margaret Hamilton directed the software engineering division of the MIT Instrumentation Laboratory. That laboratory designed the onboard flight software that enabled Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin's Apollo mission. There are many more women who have made major contributions to the field of computer science and who have gone unrecognized. Yet without these women, computer science would not be what it is today.
One piece of advice that I would give to girls who are interested in technology but not necessarily programming is to remember there are a lot of different aspects of technology and a lot of different options of things to study. My own daughter was in third grade when I started the Technology Goddesses, and grew up wanting to be a technological executive like myself. So when she got to college, she started as a computer science major. Mid-year, she called me and she said, I'm going to switch my major. I don't like programming. And I said, well, there's more to computer science than just programming. She goes, no, there isn't. I said, yes, really, there is. And so I had her look in their business school, and there's a major called information technology. And when she found it, she said, oh, yes, these are the things that I like to do. You don't have to be a coder to be a great technological professional or a great technological role model. We need more women to be role models in technology.
Technology jobs are extremely varied. You know, a lot of times people think of it as just programming, and I did spend some time as a programmer. So while I found programming interesting, I found it wasn't really for me as a long-term job. But there's a lot of jobs in technology, and they aren't all related to actually writing code. So thank goodness there are people that write code. It's just not for me.
I was really hesitant about getting into software engineering because I didn't know how a computer worked. Like, you know, I felt like I had friends or I knew people that, like, were loose acquaintances that, like, built computers back in high school or, you know, like, literally, like, knew about binary or, like, you know, stuff about, like, a basic level of how a computer worked. So I was nervous to get into software engineering because I was like, well, I don't know how a whole computer works. You know, am I going to have to figure that out? Am I going to be a disadvantage because I don't know how that works, like, in order to be in this field? And so I guess what I was pleasantly surprised with is, like, you can be a software engineer by just knowing a part of how the computer works. You know, I know the part where, like, the data interacts with where I store the data and how that all interacts with, like, the website. I don't need to understand the underworkings of, like, how networks fit together or how, like, the hard drive is used on a computer in order to be additive to this field. So I think that to me was, like, a surprise. It was, like, I could have these, like, holes in my knowledge but still be knowledgeable enough about the parts I know to be really helpful and useful and make stuff.
As the field of computer science grew, the number of women in the field continued to increase. In 1984, 37% of bachelor's degrees in computer science were awarded to women. The number of women in computer science was increasing, and it seemed that it would only keep going up.
1974, 76, at the entry-level computer programmer jobs, there was really no discrimination against women. There was no sense that women couldn't do the job because nobody really understood much what the job was then. There were so few programmers and so few colleges that taught programming languages or any kind of computer software techniques. Companies hired people who didn't know what they were doing, and to find out if they would be capable of doing computer programming, they would ask if they were good at puzzles or if they liked puzzles, and then they taught them about computer programming. So when I graduated with a computer programming background and degree, it was just really easy to get a job.
After 1984, something strange began happening. This graph shows how the number of women receiving bachelor's degrees in computer science rapidly decreases after 1984, and it never goes back up. Meanwhile, the percentage of women in nearly every other profession continued to increase. What happened to cause this sudden and unparalleled decrease? To find out, we have to look back at a major technological advancement that occurred a few years before 1984, the invention of the personal computer. Prior to 1974, no one had computers in their homes. Instead, computers, which were quite large and could occupy whole rooms, were reserved for business, industry, and government. In 1977, the first personal computer, the Altair, was released. However, its use was primarily limited to computer hobbyists.
How many of your coworkers at Venmo were classically trained versus are self-taught?
It was actually pretty 50-50, and if you look at the two founders of Venmo, you can kind of see why. They were roommates, and one of them graduated with a degree in computer science, and the other graduated with a degree in philosophy, and they both wrote a ton of code. And so I think that kind of encapsulates the two different ways that people come about it. It's they want to study a whole bunch of things, and computer science is just one of them, or they have a total focus on just computer science. So as far as the coworkers that I had at Venmo, I would say maybe a slight majority, maybe 60%, took computer science classes in college. And the other ones were, they were all into calling themselves this big word, autodidact, which means they taught themselves. And basically, they were just people who really loved learning. And so, they were interested in computer science, but also broader disciplines. And, they weren't just interested in learning one computer science language. They, wanted to know them all. And I think, computer science in general, really attracts people that are, interested in learning and teaching themselves stuff because there's, a never-ending boundary, There's only – some other disciplines, there's only so much you can learn, and then a lot of it's, experiential, learning over time, okay, this worked, that didn't work. But, there's a lot you can read about to learn in computer science.
3 years later, in 1977, the notion of having a personal computer in one's home became plausible. Three companies came out with a personal computer that year. These machines were much more accessible and much cheaper than earlier computers. For example, the TRS-80 sold for only $399. Now that computers were accessible, they began to become a household item.
Some people have big plans after school. You know what Elliot's gonna do? Jeff, too. Elliot's at work on a book report using Scripsit on Radio Shack's Color Computer 3. It hooks up to his TV. And Jeff's at his Radio Shack Color Computer 3 playing the newest football game. But wait, what's Elliot doing playing new Super Pitfall? And Jeff's having a blast with a new math tutor. You never know what you might try with more than 100 programs for fun and learning. Radio Shack's Color Computer 3 comes with everything you see here. Other items each sold separately. Only at Radio Shack.
Just like any household item, the personal computer was marketed for a particular audience, and that audience was all male.
In a world of modern fantasy and ever-changing views and computer terminology, Commodore is news. Are you keeping up with the Commodore? Because the Commodore is keeping up with you. Changing moves in a world that's full of big just keeping up with you.
Before the invention of the personal computer, few college students had experience with computing. After this invention, men had greater access to computers, which gave them an advantage over the women. Professors then began to expect more from their students in introductory level courses, but many of the women lacked that knowledge. This caused the women to question their presence in those classrooms, and it discouraged them from pursuing a major in computer science.
There are so few women entering the profession, not because of their lack of capabilities, because certainly women have proven that they're able to do the math and have the logical thinking necessary. But I think women self-select at a very young age. When I was in high school, I remember a friend of mine, we were sitting comparing at the beginning of the year what our class schedules were. And I realized she wasn't taking what we called fundamentals of college math. And I asked her why she wasn't taking that. And she said, I'm just no good at math. I laughed because I said to her, you made straight A's last year. When did you decide you weren't good at math? So I think there is that kind of self-selection that goes on that causes women to doubt their capabilities.
So a lot of women, I think, will sit back and go, gosh, I wonder, if I belong here, because obviously I'm different than everybody else. What, do I belong? And a lot of times that's called imposter syndrome. So you're sitting there waiting for somebody to figure out that you don't really know what you're talking about. I have a good friend, and she's very well educated, and she's had some very high positions as a CIO at big engineering companies, and she's just incredibly smart. And I was having lunch with her, and she asked me, sometimes I feel like I'm, doing things, and I'm wondering if people are going to figure out that I'm not real sure about what I'm doing. And so what she was describing was imposter syndrome. And I thought, wow, this highly educated, highly successful woman is feeling that same little thing inside that I'm feeling, right? And isn't that strange?
Given that women were increasingly discouraged in introductory computer science courses, they tended to drop out of the computer science major and seek alternate paths of study. Because fewer women were graduating with computer science degrees, the number of women working in the industry began to decrease, which is even more discouraging for women entering the field in subsequent years. Thus began a vicious cycle which caused a rapid decline in the number of women in computer science. As women continued to be pushed out of computer science in the academic world, other forces at play began to push them out of the workforce. Originally, programming was believed to require patience and precision, which were considered feminine skills. Women were seen as uniquely suited for this kind of work. However, as time went on, personification of an ideal programmer became a genius who was particularly puzzle-minded and somewhat of a loner. This description was inherently masculine.
Some of my preconceived notions going into robotics were that it was a nerdy activity, only meant for boys, definitely not some place for me. And I think what helped was my dad kind of pulling me in, getting me excited about it by getting me to know, the other girls in the group. And it helped that it was an all-girls robotics team, because we became friends pretty quickly. Everyone was very welcoming, and they just helped me kind of turn these stereotypes around. And so we were one of the first all-girls robotics team to get into this robotics world championships. And we perform really well, we do this community outreach, and we have a strong robot, and we have strong programming skills. And so just combining all of that wasn't something that many teams, many parents had seen prior to us, I guess, coming to this competition. Some of the discrimination we experienced at the World Championships was pretty surprising. I do remember a specific parent coming up to us because you're matched with a new team to be in alliance with before you start your next round of the competition. And this parent came up to us and asked us who helped us build our robot. That was the plain question. Who helped you build your robot? As if it was crazy that we could have done this by ourselves or hadn't needed any extra help. And you wouldn't see that parent going around and asking mixed gender teams or all male robotics teams, like, who helped them build their robot?
As technology advanced, the demand for programmers increased significantly, and corporations needed a quick and relatively cheap way of identifying the best programmers. So recruiters began relying on aptitude tests and personality profiles, which favored people who valued intellectual challenges over interpersonal relations. This resulted in companies hiring a disproportionate number of male programmers. At the same time, fewer and fewer women were graduating with a degree in computer science. Because of this, the number of women in computer science fell rapidly, and it has remained abysmally low.
My experience in computer science has been a little bit different. One, because I went to an all-women's college to study computer science. And two, because the job that I chose after college was not kind of a traditional tech job to be just a programmer at another big tech company. I chose to join a consultancy. And so at this software consulting firm, we are hired by clients to build web apps or mobile apps. It's more interesting to me to have that that piece of your job that's really about the relationships you have with people. And you're not just coding, you're not sitting in a basement, you're not fulfilling any of those stereotypes about being alone in a basement, coding in the dark type of thing. You are interacting with you're on a team, you're interacting with your client firsthand, and you're really getting to shape how you build the product and how you get feedback about it and then how you make it better. And so I find that really rewarding to be able to get to be close to the tech and get to be close to the people and work to bring those together as a developer and a consultant.
I've always said to myself that that the day it stops being interesting or I stop learning technology is the day I'll quit. And I haven't gotten there yet. I've also said every year, this is the most exciting time to ever be working in technology. Every year I've said that, and every year it's been true because it's an opportunity to grow.
My main tips for women in technology are you know, be curious, always be learning, and don't be intimidated because you don't know something, because I guarantee you everybody in technology at some point doesn't know something. It just moves that fast. So keep your sense of humor and enjoy it.